transport for flabbergasted hobbits sat speechless. Odo Proudfoot removed his feet from the table and stamped. Then there was a dead silence, until suddenly, after several deep breaths, every Baggins, Boffin, Tuke, Brandy Buck, Grub, Chubb, Burrows, Bulger, Bracegirdle, Brockhouse, Goodbody, Hornblower, and Proudfoot began to talk at once. It was generally agreed that the joke was in very bad taste, and more food and drink were needed to cure guests of shock and annoyance.
"He's mad, I always said so,"
was probably the most popular comment. Even the Tukes, with a few exceptions, thought Bilbo's behaviour was absurd. For the moment, most of them took it for granted that his disappearance was nothing more than a ridiculous prank. But old Rory Brandybuck was not so sure. Neither age nor an enormous dinner had tired his wits, and he said to his daughter-in-law, Esmeralda,
"There's something fishy in this, my dear. I believe that mad Baggins is off again. Silly old fool, but why worry? He hasn't taken the oath with him."
He called loudly to Frodo to send the wine round again. Frodo was the only one present who had said nothing. For some time he had sat silent beside Bilbo's empty chair, and ignored all remarks and questions. He had enjoyed the joke, of course, even though he had been in the know. He had difficulty in keeping from laughter at the indignant surprise of the guests, but at the same time, he felt deeply troubled. He realized suddenly that he loved the old hobbit theory. Most of the guests went on eating and drinking, and discussing Bilbo Baggins' oddities, past and present, but the Sackville Bagginses had already departed in wrath. Frodo did not want to have any more to do with the party. He gave orders for more wine to be served, then he got up and drained his own glass silently, to the health of Bilbo, and slipped out of the pavilion. As for Bilbo Baggins, even while he was making his speech, he had been fingering the golden ring in his pocket, his magic ring that he had kept secret for so many years. As he stepped down, he slipped it on his finger, and he was never seen by any hobbit in Hobbiton again. He walked briskly back to his hole, and stood for a moment listening with a smile to the din in the pavilion and to the sounds of merrymaking in other parts of the field. Then he went in. He took off his party clothes, folded up and wrapped in tissue paper his embroidered silk waistcoat, and put it away. Then he put on quickly some old untidy garments, and fastened round his waist a worn leather belt. On it he hung a short sword in a battered black leather scabbard. From a locked drawer, smelling of old mothballs, he took out an old cloak and hood. They had been locked up as if they were very precious, but they were so patched and weather-stained that their original color could hardly be guessed. It might have been dark green. They were rather too large for him. He then went into his study, and from a large strong box, took out a bundle wrapped in old cloths, and a leather-bound manuscript, and also a large bulky envelope. The book and bundle he stuffed into the top of a heavy bag that was standing there, already nearly full. Into the envelope he slipped his golden ring, and its fine chain, and then sealed it, and addressed it to Frodo. At first he put it on the mantelpiece, but suddenly he removed it and stuck it in his pocket. At that moment, the door opened and Gandalf came quickly in.
"Oh!
Hello," said Bilbo. "Though I wondered if you had turn up."
"I am glad to find you visible,"
replied the wizard, sitting down in the chair.
"I wanted to catch you and have a few final words."